Welcome to the Thoughtful Gamer Podcast, episode number 39. As always, my name is Mark, and here with me today is Orion.
Hello.
And we're just going to talk about some games. This is going to be a casual one for us.
So casual, we're not even bothering to call it the Chillcast 3 because we haven't found a catchy subtitle. So it's...
I don't know. It doesn't feel like a real Chillcast.
Okay.
It's more like a podcast that is also chill.
It's more of a con review, to be honest.
That's true.
And by con, we mean a one-day event at the New Hampshire Comicon.
Mm-hmm.
There was a board game room run by the G2 Summit people, the lovely folks there.
Yeah. And so we went up there, we played a bunch of games, and we went disc golfing, which was awesome. And then we came back sweaty and stinky and played some more games. And I apologize to those we played with if they smelled us. I was trying to stay away from people because I knew I was just coated in sweat. We played a lot of disc golf.
We did. We played a full two rounds, 36 holes, and that second course was intense.
Yeah, pro tip, if you're ever at the disc golf course in Manchester, New Hampshire, the south course is very difficult and very rough. It's narrow. It doesn't seem as polished. They haven't put as much work into actually clearing out the forest that it's housed in. Because if you leave the clearings, you're in a ravine surrounded by thorny bushes. If I had worn shorts, which I almost did, I would have lost half of my discs because there was no way I was going to be able to walk through those bushes with bare legs.
Yeah, and also the second one covered more rough terrain. I remember a lot of steep gullies and ravines that we had to throw across and sometimes dive, go down to retrieve discs out of.
Yeah, it was.
But it was a lot of fun.
I'm going to stay in the North Course in the future.
Yeah, probably. The North Course, I shot a 9, you shot a something in the teens. On the South Course, we both shot a 24 or something.
Over par.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, over par, to be clear. We're not that good.
We're not very good at all, yeah.
And then
I felt like I played better on the second course. It was just that much more difficult.
Oh, you probably did. I mean, my score decreased by 14, and your score only decreased by 8 or something.
Yeah.
So, yeah, for sure.
But, yeah, it was tough. But we are here to talk about board games. We have three main games, I think, to talk about. I guess I could talk about the other ones we played there, but three that were really interesting. We finally got to play Baseball Highlights 2045, I believe, is the number attached to that.
That's the one you told me.
That is the number I remember, which is a game I've been wanting to play for a while because there aren't that many good sports games out there, and I've heard this one's pretty much the best, at least in terms of being a good game that's also about sports. It's not particularly simulationist or anything, but it's still a good game. We got to play Role Player, which is a dice game I've been hearing a lot about in the last year or two, and we ended up playing that. And not at the convention, but recently, because I got a review copy, we have been playing Root, which is the hottest game in board gaming at the moment, according to my unscientific survey of social media and also the slightly more scientific board game geek hotness ratings. And I think we'll have a slightly different opinion of the game, at least on our first impressions from the first couple of plays, than we've been seeing online. It's an interesting game.
Yeah, for sure.
But we will get to that later. Let's first start talking about Baseball Highlights, because we got to the convention. There was basically no one else there. We got there in the morning, and we're trying to figure out a game to play. I'm like, oh, hey, I know that's a two-player game, and it's supposed to be good with two players. And let's see how it is. So we pulled it out. It was actually much more simple than I thought it was. I thought it was a solidly, midweight game, and I would say it's on the lighter side.
Yeah.
Especially for a deck builder. I suppose it would be harder if you didn't know baseball, because it does kind of assume that you know a lot of baseball terms, but basic baseball terms.
It assumes basic terms, not advanced.
You don't need to know what a double switch is or anything. Maybe in an expansion, that would be actually kind of cool. But
you need to know what the different hits are, the direction to run the bases.
Yes, the rule book was very specific that you need to run the bases in the correct direction.
That was really about it,
honestly. Yeah, at least in the base game.
There were a bunch of expansions in the box that we did not play.
Yeah, and I don't know if there were modules that come in the base game or if that copy just had other expansions included in the box. But I believe... No, I think those come with the base games as like an optional, a few optional modules because it had rules for them in the rulebook.
Okay.
I do know that it has a ton of expansion material out there. You can buy like an $80 or $90 version of the game with tons and tons of expansions. But it was a really simple deck builder. And it was interesting because as you play the game, you're not just playing a single baseball game. You're playing through this kind of mini season of... It was a 4 out of 7 series.
Yeah.
You're first player to win 4 games.
You could imagine it as you're playing the World Series of this futuristic robo-baseball.
Yeah. And I thought it was really cool how it took almost the experience of like just playing a hand of cards and made that its own little mini game. Where in a typical deck builder, that would just be, you know, your turn. But it turned that into a little mini game.
And you go back and forth, so it's almost like deck building crossed with wargaming, but like the simplest possible version of both of those.
Yeah, incredibly simple. Like, oh, look, I play this person and they're threatening a hit. And then you can play a card that says, no, you do not have a hit. Like, that's the level of interaction you're getting in the base game. And you'd think that that would be super dull, but it was really interesting. Not the first time through, because you don't have any decisions on how to craft your deck. How it works is that after each game, the cards you play give you a currency, and then you draft new players and replace cards in your deck with better players from the intergame draft or the midgame draft.
Yeah, so you start with a deck of, I think, 15 cards, mostly rookies and a few veterans who have very basic powers of, you know, hit a double or cancel a hit, things like that. And then you can upgrade those after each game to more interesting cards from the center, which will give you more efficient hitting or more flexible defense or more income or various things like that.
Yeah, and the art design and the kind of production of it was really fun. It's this futuristic, but kind of retro futuristic style of cyborgs and robots playing baseball. Like, one of them literally looked like the trash can robot from Star Wars with a slot in it and a bat sticking out. And it was like the Robo Batter 2000 or something. It was really, I enjoyed the art style of it. Not quite steampunk, but heading that direction, I think.
Yeah.
You know, closer to like Tin Man from The Wizard of Oz than, I don't know, X science fiction movie.
It would almost be more like if you took descriptions or pictures of robots imagined in like the 50s.
Yeah, yeah, it's that 50s style for sure.
But yeah, it was fun. It was interesting. We played Mark 1, I think, 4-2, maybe?
I believe so,
something like that. But there was back and forth. There was interesting decision-making. We got made fun of for taking it too seriously and playing it too long or something.
The box said 45 minutes. I think we took about 45 minutes once we read the rules.
Yeah, we probably did.
Yeah. It's cool how, because I always wondered how it did it. And we've kind of brainstormed a bit on how to translate sports into board gaming, and baseball seems the most natural fit, but even within kind of the very discrete structure of baseball, it was really elegant in how it simulated the game, because on your turn you would play a single card, and say it's just a person who is going to hit a double. You play that card down, and essentially at that point you're threatening to hit a double. And then your opponent gets to play their card, and some of the cards have defensive abilities. Most of them had offensive abilities. A lot of the ones you'd buy later in the game would have both, or pitching abilities or something. And so the card that Orion plays might say, turn all hits into walks and also threaten a single. And so once he plays his card, then my card from the previous turn resolves. So if nothing defensive or pitching happens, it would resolve as displayed. If not, it gets modified or canceled in some way. And you only have six cards. So you're trying to arrange your cards to do very obvious things like do your singles and doubles first and then try to end with a home run. But because there are the pitching and defensive cards, you know that perhaps your opponent might be holding one back because they know you're going to try to hit in all your batters at the last card. And so maybe you try to bluff, you know, a couple runs at the beginning, but know you can get more later on if they use up their cancel card. So there's a little bit of kind of trying to outthink your opponent, a little bit of bluffing, but it's all really light to the touch, which I liked.
Yeah, and it was interesting how it kind of abstracts the idea of, in baseball, you go back and forth with a turn at bat, you know, top and bottom of an inning, and this, you go back and forth playing a total of six cards each.
Yeah, the rule book says that in this distant future, baseball has been shortened to six innings because, I believe, of decreased attention spans and desire for TV ratings. That's why they also allowed robots.
And cyborgs.
Yeah. Yes.
but it kind of abstracted it away because each card was 0 to 3 hits. And on its own, it might not score any. But if you can chain multiple get together, it could kind of be a really good hitting inning. But then if they played defensive abilities, it could end up being a wash. So I don't know. I doubt I would have come up with that way of abstracting things down, but still retaining that kind of back and forth tension, I guess.
I think it did a pretty good job. I would be really interested to see how the expansions expanded and how they deepen the game, because the base game starts with a really simple, basic game, and I can see tons of potential for much more complicated card play. And even like, I didn't check to see if the rulebook supports this, but even like longer series or like season play type things,
yeah,
would be really interesting. I think the system could support that. I think I've heard that that is supported, at least with some of the expansions, but it seems kind of like a nice platform for a lot of iteration, which I think they have done. And then coming up, they have the football game. Mike Fitzgerald, the designer, is doing football highlights 20-something.
Cool.
So it'll be interesting to see how that's different from the baseball one.
Mm-hmm. The other kind of fun thing was a lot of the players had these mixed names. So you'd get like Barry Sosa. I forget the example.
Sandy Gibson, I think, was one.
It was all these like blending of names from famous baseball players. And you're like, oh, well, that's clearly those two players. And some of them actually kind of fit the theme of, be like, oh, this should clearly be a power hitter based on.
Yeah, I believe Barry Sosa just threatened 2 home runs or 3 home runs.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so clever little game. I'm glad I played it. Late to the party on that one. But, you know, if I see it on sale, I might pick it up, actually.
Yeah, sure.
I think it'd be fun to explore, especially if it has some expansion material with it. I can see the base game by itself kind of wearing out pretty quickly.
Yeah. There's a lot of cards, so you wouldn't end up with the same ones, but the play would end up being pretty similar without something to spice it up.
Mm-hmm. I think probably the best game we played at the convention was Role Player, which, again, another game that has come out in the last couple of years, and I'd heard a lot of good things about it, and we happened to catch someone who had just finished reading through the rules, looking for players, and we hopped in on the game. And it was a lot of fun.
You liked this better than the other unnamed game that we played on Saturday.
It was newer. It's fresher. Sure, I would give them a very similar rating. the other game being El Grande.
Yep.
The classic. But I think I'm just realizing that dice drafting is just a mechanism that I love in almost any context. I can't think of a dice drafting game I don't like.
Pioneer Days, Pulsar are two notable examples.
Castles of Burgundy,
of course.
Big one.
You're, what's that, like top 12 for you or something?
Top 15.
I think it was low teens.
Did it hit the top 10? It might have hit the top 10.
Maybe it did.
Maybe. It's anyways. Around there. Yeah, and I is that all the dice drafting games we have? I feel like I should have more. Is it just Pulsar, Castles of Burgundy, and Pioneer Days? That's all I see on the shelf.
Dice drafting. That's all that jumps to mind. I feel like there ought to be another one that we're missing, but nothing doesn't come to mind. So
maybe I should look into getting more dice drafting games.
Maybe you should.
Yeah.
Quantum uses some of the principles of different faces being meaningful beyond their number, but it's not really drafting.
It's not drafting, no. I like drafting generally. I mean, I like Seven Wonders a lot.
Yeah.
Anyway.
It was great.
Yeah, it was great. In Roleplayer,
you start with you kind of have a character sheet, and the setup of the game is kind of, you draw, you know, a class and a race and a background and an alignment and a different things like this, and essentially you're designing the character that you're trying to build. And then throughout the game, you draft dice and you purchase items to try to essentially level up and build that character to achieve certain endgame stats. And then based on how many of those different goals you hit, you get points for each one of those. So, for example, maybe your warrior wants strength of 16 or 17 and dex of 12 and constitution of 18 plus. And right. So you'll draft dice throughout the game, and each of your main stats, you know, the classic six, strength, dex, con, int, wisdom, charisma.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, each one of those has three slots for dice, and you total the face that's up. So sixes are, well, generally you want high numbers, so you're trying to reach a certain high total. But then also each stat, when you place a die into that row, it has some power that most of them let you either modify your dice or move them or manipulate them in some way to move towards your goals. And initially, like our initial roll, I think you rolled like four sixes or something of your initial stats.
I think I had like two sixes and two fives. It was high.
And I rolled probably a more average distribution.
I think you rolled exactly average. I counted it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh man, this seems like such a variable starting position, but you have so much ability to like flip dice or re-roll them or bump them by one or different powers like that, that it gives you a lot of flexibility to mitigate that opening randomness.
Yeah, it brings to mind, there's a lot to talk about with this one, but it brings to mind something I've been pondering for a while that I don't think I've written or spoke about yet, and that is games that are really generous. And by generous, I mean kind of the opposite of a Twilight Struggle or a T'Zolk'in or an Agricola.
Agricola, yeah.
Yeah. Games that, however they do it, make it feel like everyone is progressing, even if some people end up, you know, like in our game, I like doubled everyone's score. I managed to get everything done really well. But I think everyone else had the feeling throughout the game that they were progressing and accomplishing things that they wanted to accomplish, and they didn't feel like they had made some kind of epic failure during the game.
Yeah, and I wasn't paying super close attention to the score, but I didn't know who was winning until the end. Maybe you thought you were winning.
I pretty much accomplished everything I could to get points, so I felt pretty good. But yeah. I didn't think it was going to be that dramatic.
Yeah, the score sheet goes to 50. It's like 1 to 50, and you scored 49, I think.
Yeah, 49. I almost made it to the 50.
The rest of us were in the 20s somewhere.
Mid to late 20s, yeah.
Yeah.
But it feels like a very generous game. And when I think about it, I always enjoy games like that, that feel generous, that feel like, oh, I'm getting more resources than I thought I would, or, wow, that ability is more powerful than I thought it would be. In this case, it's like, wow, I can change these dice so many times and really try to fine-tune what my attribute ratings are going to be, much more than I thought at the beginning of the game.
Yeah, like the strength power is you get to flip a die. So if you drop if you get stuck at the end, like the last draft, and you get a 1, which normally would be miserable for trying to hit your 15 to 18 stat goal,
mm-hmm.
you can place it in strength and flip it to be a six.
Yeah. It's super generous like that. And my thought is, I'm just throwing this out there, that games like that, especially Euro games, can be good. They can be really good. I don't know if they could be among the best games ever. I think the generosity makes the experience really good, but maybe it... I feel like it
raises the floor but lowers the ceiling a little bit.
Yeah, that's my impression.
Hmm.
As kind of a general statement. I don't know.
I was going to say, because you've criticized other games for giving you too many resources.
Yeah.
That one space game, I don't remember the name. The one where you kind of explore planets and build out in these rows.
Oh, the prototype I got?
Yeah, the prototype.
Yeah. Stellar Leap.
I remember that one specifically. You were saying you got too much stuff.
Yeah, right? You were just swimming in it. It was too easy to get things.
Some of your other games, you rate Agricola pretty highly, and that's extremely tight.
Yeah, in Twilight Struggle. I mean, I like Noosefjord because it's stupidly generous with resources. It's another game that just feels so generous. But like Role Player, it doesn't go too much. It doesn't feel easy, but it does feel rewarding.
I think it doesn't remove meaningful decisions.
Yeah.
Where I think Stellar Leap might have kind of just nudged the other side of that line of there was clearly always an obvious play from what I remember.
Yeah.
Whereas in this, I'd have to play it again to be able to better say, but it felt like there were at least from the kind of a macro view, there were different paths you could take to try to hit your goal.
Yes, absolutely.
And one thing we kind of discovered halfway through was that there are cards that give you points for tanking stats, like having less,
like really tanking,
like less than 8 or less than 5 in a stat. You could get points for that. Whereas your was it your class? I think your class would give you about 2 points per stat for hitting the goals.
Mm-hmm.
But you could buy these, were they traits maybe?
Something like that, yeah.
You could buy weapons, armor, skills, and traits. And probably the skills and traits would both move you along on your alignment grid, your classic good, evil, lawful, chaotic grid.
That was a fun thematic thing.
Yeah. And you had like one of the squares was your goal alignment. And then, like, the opposite edge of the grid would be minus points. So you'd get 3 points for hitting. I was an orc, druid, and I don't remember my alignment, but I was trying to get to chaotic evil.
Mm-hmm.
And so lawful good was -3, and the other two were -1. Mm-hmm. And hitting my alignment directly was +3.
Yeah. I don't know if I have anything more to say about kind of generous games, but that's my impression, that there's kind of a ceiling for those kinds of games just because they remove a lot of tension, and I like tension in games. Although I also like really pleasant, generous games, but I don't know. Besides that, back to Role Player.
Anyways, I thought there were still interesting decisions to be made.
Oh, sure.
And there was definitely skill in playing the game and a better strategy or a better plan. There's plenty of randomness in which items come up and things like that. And of course, you're dice drafting, so there's that inherent randomness. But there was definitely room for a good strategy to beat a bad one.
Yeah, and you're given, it's really well balanced in kind of the long-term strategy you're given at the beginning of the game, and then goals that you pick up as you go. Because initially, when you hear that it's a game about kind of creating a role-playing character, you think, oh, it's just about kind of the initial creation. It's really more about finishing a role-playing character, because you end up, first of all, with really high stats, unless you specifically decide to tank, you know, one for different cards. But you're also gathering traits and abilities and equipment along the way. So it's like taking the role-playing narrative and cutting out all of the narrative parts, almost, or rather leaving them to implication.
Yeah, it was entirely kind of abstracted down to grinding your stats through these different acquisitions. And there was no built-in, like, you have an encounter and you fight this thing and, oh, you level up and now you get a new die. And I suppose you could kind of imagine that onto the theme. And I think you kind of did.
Oh, yeah. The narrative that was created through my stupid halfling that I made was hilarious, because I pull out halfling and then I get a chaotic evil alignment, called Lunatic or Savage or something. One was Lunatic and the other was Savage. And my class was Cleric. So already it's a contradiction.
Your background was Savage and your alignment was Lunatic.
And then the first two, was it traits or the ones you work towards?
Yeah.
Traits, which are basically like mid-game goals, because it's like you get points if you accomplish this thing. My first two were honesty and loyalty.
Yeah.
And then I got, I don't remember the one in between, but the fourth one I got was famous. And then there was another, like, there was a really bad one. So it was like,
proud or vain or something?
Yeah, proud and then famous.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it was like I was this sociopath that had spent the entire game pretending to be honest and loyal and a good person to rise to fame, only to fall down again or revel in my fame or whatever, because I ended up scoring well. But it has that narrative by implication thing that reminds me of Suburbia, where you're trying to just do what you can to get points during the game, but once you finish and take a step back and look at everything, it kind of paints a story or a narrative of your character, which I thought was really cool.
Yeah, I didn't really hit that as much.
One of the guys we played with was this barbarian or warrior orc.
Oh, yeah.
And he just loaded up on armor the whole game.
Yeah. His class let him, like, bump a die every time he bought a piece of armor or something. So he had, like, three full sets of gear. He had, like, a full set of robes, and then he had a full set of chain armor and maybe one or two other random pieces.
Not quite a full set. I had to stop him because the armor...
Oh, yeah. It's a sect collection thing. Yeah. Kind of like science in...
Seven Wonders.
So it was an exponential curve. More valuable, yeah.
So I had to block some of that chain link armor from him.
Yeah, that would have gotten up to being like 14 points if he got it all or something like that.
Yeah, it was going to be high.
But yeah, no, it was. He just like kept putting on more clothes and more armor to like feel better about himself and become more powerful or something.
It would have fit the character. Like,
yeah.
Mine was a contradiction that kind of painted a story. His was just this hilarious character that just kept collecting armor and putting it on, and it kind of worked because he had like a leather set and then a chainmail set and then this whole set of robes,
like the mystic set or something.
Yeah, yeah. it was very funny. But yeah, tons of dice manipulation, like way more than you'd think, so that you can really get to a position you want to be in, or at least get close to one or feel like you have the potential. The drafting element was really nice, because you would roll the dice, similar to Pulsar, not quite as interesting or intricate as Pulsar, but someone would roll the dice, you set them up lowest to highest, and the lowest one would take the first initiative on buying equipment and traits in the buy phase. So there was always that inherent trade-off between low dice and getting the equipment you wanted,
mm-hmm.
Which was well done. You got to see the equipment beforehand, so you could plan ahead. It integrated the colors of the dice as another little facet in the game, which was nice.
Which we didn't realize until the end of the game, but you get points for having dice of your character's color or your class's color.
Yeah, we forgot about that as a point scoring thing. But I ended up grabbing a trait that wanted me to line up similar colored dice in columns.
Yeah, I had the one rose, which I completely sucked at.
Yeah.
You crushed yours.
Well, I was able to pick up one that let me just move dice around once per turn.
You also found that stupid gold dagger.
The gold dagger was amazing.
Plus the one jewel. To all gold dice. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So I was bringing in, it was very good. I had a nice confluence of abilities that worked well together.
I had the sweet spear that, in a 4-player game, the initiatives go 1 to 5. And you roll 5, you know, N plus 1 die and put them on each track. And the middle 3 initiatives, 2 through 4, have a gold piece on them. So if you choose a middle initiative, you get that. And then my spear that I bought on the first turn gave me an extra gold whenever I picked one of those. So that funded a lot of purchases for me.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And then there's other little things, like if you take a gold die, you get 2 gold. And if you finish a row... So each of your stats has 3 slots. Whenever you finish the third slot or you place it in the third slot, you get a gold. And then the skills and traits, when you buy the trait, they generally give you points for accomplishing some goal or something like that. But they also would move you on the alignment when you bought them. And then the skills would move you on the alignment chart when you used them. So you can kind of buy skills with your alignment goal in mind. So if you, like me, were going to be chaotic evil at the end, I ended up buying these like cure wounds and heal cards because they synergized with my druid class of green dice.
Mm.
And they let me do things like bump your dice stats and stuff, but they kept moving me up. So I had to wait until the end and then save my last couple alignment moves to go get back down into the good chaotic, the chaotic evil yeah. corner that I was targeting. So
yeah, really pleasant game. I have heard around the grapevine that the expansion is very, very good.
Mm-hmm. You said it was kind of a co-op competitive thing of you fight a monster at the end, but you're trying to do the most damage or something.
Yeah, I glanced through the rule book and that's what it looked like. It's a beefy expansion. It's like a $35 expansion. I don't know how much the base game costs, but it can't be more than 40 or 50, I imagine.
There are a lot of dice in there, which usually are expensive.
Yeah, nice dice, too.
Yeah.
Like almost casino quality, like hard-edged.
Yeah, they were nice.
Good quality dice.
Great inserts were with slots for to set dice into.
Mm-hmm.
Love
yep,
it.
Yep. And just really an enjoyable game.
Yeah. It was probably the most fun game we played.
I'd say so. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, in terms of like the quality of the game.
Mm-hmm.
A couple people on the live stream are commenting about other dice drafting games. We forgot to mention Sagrada,
yeah,
which we played once, which was fun, lighter yeah. on the lighter side, looks beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
And then
drafting dice to fill in a stained glass window.
Yeah. And then obviously there's coming up, did you see this? The makers of Azul are making a game, I believe a dice drafting game or some kind of game about constructing a stained glass window.
Oh, it's really?
It's very strange to see that announcement.
Huh, no. I don't follow news as much as you, but I had not seen that.
And then the other one that some people from the Patreon enjoy is Trois, which I've heard is good. I think it got a really good review from Shut Up and Sit Down, but I have not played it.
Okay.
Kind of relatively older, I think within 10 years, but maybe on the longer side of 10 years.
I mean, 10 years is like an eternity in board gaming.
Yeah, I mean, we're getting to the point, like, maybe 15 is kind of the big bulk of.
Okay, I guess 15 goes back to 2003, which is not many modern games are older than that.
Yeah, I mean, Pandemic's 10 years old, Dominion's 10 years old.
Yeah.
Which is nuts.
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to talk about any of the other games we played there? Played that trick-taking game, which was interesting.
Just briefly mention, yeah, what was it? Sticheln or something?
Sticheln?
I'm butchering
that game's game. Like 25 years old. It was really in the 90s, yeah.
It was an interesting trick-taking game where everything except for the lead suit is trump. And at the beginning of each hand, you have to declare a suit that counts negative if you take. So every trick you take is 1 point per card. And then every card of that suit, the cards go 0 to 14, is minus X points, where X is the value of the card. Mm-hmm. So you could lose 14 points on one card, which some people did.
Yes.
There were
two of the five people playing ended up in negative points.
Like negative 40 plus.
Yeah.
I think the winner was 40 something.
Yeah.
I had in the 30s.
I was in the teens, I think.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun, I think primarily because we had a fun group of people playing,
mm-hmm.
and we were all a little bit loopy because it was late.
Yeah.
I think if you were playing it at another time in another setting, it might not have been as interesting.
Yeah, we both kind of figured out that you want to, because every non-lead suit is trump, you want to just choose the suit as your pain suit that you have the most cards of generally, unless there was a bunch of high ones.
Yeah.
But usually
as long as
just
you have a couple low
cards,
ones,
yeah.
you want the suit that you have the most of, because leading or following suit is like the least powerful play and the least likely to win a hand.
Yeah, so as long as you have like 3 to 4 relatively low values of that suit,
yeah,
as you just try to, you always lead with those, get them off the table, and then even if you lead later on, if someone's forced to go off suit, they auto take the hand.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's fairly easy to dump later on as long as you don't have all high cards of your pain suit.
Yeah.
But beyond that, it was enjoyable, but I don't think there was anything crazy there.
I've certainly would prefer nearly every other trick taker I've played. Not that I've played a lot of them, but I'd rather play in a average setting. Like, I'd prefer hearts, I think.
Sure. You played Tribe, which looked really interesting.
Oh yeah, Tribe. It's a Japanese game.
I wasn't there for the initial, but that was the impression.
It's either Japanese or Korean.
Because the guy imported it from somewhere, I think.
Yeah, from Asia somewhere. I think he said most of his games that he brought were Japanese or Korean. I can't remember about that one, but it's called Tribe. And it's a dexterity kind of balance game. You have these nearly two-dimensional human figures and then all these different shapes of various colors. And it's actually has a fairly intricate points system. And that would actually be my biggest criticism of the game, is that it's kind of difficult to figure out where you have the potential to score points, because you have to count like how many of a particular shape have been played already, or how many of a particular color on each individual person. But any kind of stacking, balancing game is going to be hilarious. And this one was people trying to do ridiculous things. There was this fish shape that this guy stuck on like the human figure's neck, and then he put a rooster on top of it, and then I balanced this ring on the rooster's tail. It was
nuts. Another one where you had this like chain going down of Link within.
It was literally a chain, yeah.
You had like 3 or 4 links going down off of this horizontal bar that someone had balanced.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean,
and then at the end you have like all these like it gets. There's like these 5 figures that you're stacking things on, and you can't have the same color or the same shape touch.
Yeah, which was difficult by the end of the game.
Yeah, and it looked like by the end you were just trying to find a place to put anything, and then you lose a point every time you knock a piece off. And the one guy like was going for an ambitious play, and he had hit like 3 of these in a row, and then he went 1 too far and knocked over the whole thing.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that looked like a blast.
Yeah, the annoying part was just making sure you weren't, like, opening up the next person to score, like, a 1 or 2 point play.
Yeah.
And then trying to see if there were any scoring opportunities of your own.
Yeah.
But in terms of balancing, I mean, that's always really fun. Mm-hmm. I can't wait. I'm hoping it's at the next local convention, the construction card stacking
dexterity
game I played a few months ago. Hopefully that comes out soon. I would love to get my hands on it. I think that was at G2? Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah.
That's probably my favorite stacking dexterity game I've ever played. Not that I've played many.
Mm-hmm.
And I've played...
Those two?
I mean, I played Jenga.
Oh, yeah, that's... Well, yeah, okay.
Yeah, that might be it.
Anyways.
I don't play a lot of dexterity
games. Those were a couple other smaller games that were fun. We played El Grande at the end of the night.
Just great.
Which is... It's the big.
Is it better the second time, Orion?
It is better the second time. I think there are... I'm a little biased because I just crushed this game and won handily.
Yeah, you were, what, 20, 30 points ahead of me and I was in second?
I think the first time we played this, the winner was in like the high 90s maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe just over 100. And this game, I hit like 120 or something.
Yeah.
And you were the closest at 110-ish?
I don't know if I hit 110. I think I barely
you broke 100. You broke 100, but and then everyone else had not broken 100. And now it sounds like I'm boasting or something. The point was just that it was not as cutthroat as the first time we played.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a couple things that made it better. One is I knew the cards that could come out. So I knew the sorts of things that could come out. Because there are some mean cards that can show up. And we also played a rule correctly this time, where instead of the first bid just passing to the left,
yeah,
it goes to whoever was the lowest initiative on the previous round.
Yeah, which I screwed that up initially, which was significant.
Rule. We read this rule, but we interpreted the rule book wrong.
Yeah.
The first time we played, which definitely makes the game a lot better, because one of the criticisms we had was that in a certain player count game, you would just never get to go first on a valuable turn or on like the scoring.
The round right before scoring.
Whereas with this, you can set yourself up by going low the, you know, penultimate turn and then having the chance to play high on the scoring turn.
Right.
To set yourself up to grab the scoring card you want or the king card, you know, whatever. So that made it better. Knowing the cards made it a little better. It was less, there was less take that, which I thought made it better. There's other area control games I would prefer, but, and I won, so I'm a little biased there, but it was better the second time.
Yeah. I still think Dominant Species is basically the best of that kind of game I've played. And I would always prefer it, but I still think El Grande is really, really good.
Yeah. Anyways, on to the other game, which we talked about on Saturday, but because a bunch of the other people had been playing it recently.
Everyone's playing it.
Like, okay.
Everyone in the world.
When you put it, I came back and it was on the table and it kind of looks like this, I don't know, the art style almost feels like this indie game to me.
I mean, it's only their second game they've made.
Okay.
Leader Games, I think. I think Vast was their first title. Really?
That was their game. It's the same company.
Yeah, I think Vast and Root are the only two games they've made.
Interesting.
Okay. Or they have a kind of a sequel to Vast that's either has been, I think it's been kickstarted but hasn't been released yet.
Okay.
Maybe.
So, what do you think of Root? We've played it 3 times now?
I've played it 3 times.
You've played it 3 times. I've played it twice.
Yeah. Every time at 3 players, so I haven't played the full 4 players. We haven't played with the Vagabond yet because it wasn't recommended for 3 players, although I was given assurances at the convention that
just
play different configurations and it works itself out. I think it has the potential to be good. I don't understand why everyone's raving about it so much.
I don't think it's good the first time.
Yeah, but I mean, I get that that's the experience they're going for. Like, there are some games that aren't going to be good the first time. That's fine.
It's worth noting. It's not necessarily a black mark.
Sure. Yeah, it's worth noting. I don't think that problem is nearly as severe as with Vast. Vast seems much, much more contingent on the players all understanding the game at a fairly deep level to actually just balance the game and make it work as a competitive exercise. Root, once we've played correctly, I screw up the rules quite a bit on the first play, but our other two games have been pretty close. We've been fairly good at self-balancing. It's not that hard to figure out like who's in a better position or who's poised to win.
Yeah,
there's a couple things.
Both games have had a fairly similar kind of scoring arc.
Right.
Where the birds, they score a little bit initially and then collapse and usually lose all or most of their points and tend to fall way behind. And then their second decree that they set up their second time through,
they start
scoring a lot more. And I think if you play well there, that's kind of your best chance to kind of overtake everyone else and hit 30 and win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Or I suppose you could go for the domination victory, but that's a separate deal. The cats, which I have not played, I've seen played twice now, but I have not played them.
They have a really good beginning.
They
game.
Start with the whole map controlled and then just lose position from there and have to struggle to maintain as much as they can. So I think both times you've gotten to a point where you ran out of places to score points by building things.
Right.
And that was the biggest limiting factor.
Yeah. Well, let's talk basically, I mean, everyone's playing it, but you know, that's not a literal everyone. Let's talk basically how the game works. It is a kind of area control asymmetric war game. The coin games, I know, were an inspiration for the designer. Vast was obviously an inspiration, kind of the extreme asymmetry that they did with Vast, although, like we said, it's toned down a little bit. And I think just general area control combat games, like direct interaction. I see a lot of like Comet in there and games like that, you know, Blood Rage maybe, in terms of just having a really claustrophobic battlefield and trying to kind of outrace the other players rather than conquer them within the the confines of a direct interaction, violent style game. At least for the birds and the cats. The Woodland Alliance has a different thing going on, and I know the Vagabond is really
I see more like coin inspiration than other like standard area control.
Yeah, I think there's a bit of this, bit of that.
And maybe just because every race scores on different things.
Yeah.
So
I mean, it's certainly inspired by coin in that regard, and kind of inspired by coin in that there are different ways to control or different ways to exploit a given area. So coin always, the coin games that we played almost entirely or entirely have kind of a dual way of control. There's like, it's really explicit in Fire in the Lake, where you can have military control and you can have the support of the population.
Right.
And those are two separate things. There's a little bit of that in Root. There is a way to have rule over a given area, control, like military control. But you can also have, in certain situations, two different buildings from different factions in the same area and getting benefits from that.
Mm-hmm.
So a little bit of that, but it doesn't have the card play that coin does. It uses a completely different card system just to make things simpler, I think. It doesn't have an event deck, which I think is pretty critical to coin games, how that plays out. That's where it really differentiates itself.
Yep.
Instead, it has these kind of multi-purpose cards that are based on suits. There are three main suits. There's another suit that's wild. And they're kind of used a bit differently by every faction that we've played, at least.
You should also say you're battling over this series of woodland clearings.
Mm-hmm.
And there's kind of a, I don't know, it's, to use a mathematical term, it's a map. But
it's each point to point.
Yeah, each clearing connects to about three other clearings. And each clearing also has a suit, a type of clearing. So what are they? The fox, the mice, and the bunny.
Mm-hmm.
And there's four of each of those clearings, so 12 total. And you are vying for control of those clearings, but control is generally a means to the end of scoring. So generally, you need control to be able to build something, which is how you actually score most of the time.
Yes, which is really nice. There's also this kind of side game about like crafting things.
Yeah,
and which is generally, again,
that's more the area control thing.
Well, it's almost like another layer. Like, you want to control areas to put things in that area and establish yourself, and then that establishing yourself typically helps you craft things.
Yeah.
At least, again, for the birds and the cats, which operate most closely. The Woodland Alliance is, again, kind of the wonky one of those three of the four main ones we've played.
They're more of the reaction to those other two, because the first two, the cats and the birds, are these fairly straightforward militaristic factions who are trying to rule the whole woods and then do things, having ruled areas, do things to score points.
Right.
The Woodland Alliance is the they're trying to stir up sympathy.
They're like the guerrilla faction. They're
the guerrilla warfare. They're
like the Viet Cong almost.
Yeah, exactly. And
in Fire in the Lake.
Every time one of the other factions moves in or attacks them, they get a card, which they can use to kind of rebuild their sympathy.
And when you look at it from like individual mechanism standpoints, there's so much cleverness here. The thing you just talked about, the sympathy being represented by cards that you have to give to the other player when you interfere in their space, that thematically makes a lot of sense and it works out really nicely.
The decree is brilliant. That might be my favorite part of the game.
I love the bird's decree. It's the best, I think the best way of representing kind of bureaucratic bloat that I've ever seen in a board game. Because how it works is that you have four main actions and you begin the game with a card
recruit,
in two of them.
Recruit, move, battle, and build.
And every turn you add one or two cards to that decree.
You must.
You have to. And then you have to do all of those things on your turn, everything that's in your decree. And the cards you play into that will also determine where you can do them. So the suit of the card will determine where, like, if you put a fox card in the battle section, you have to battle in a fox section,
which means
you have to be in a situation where you have units and opposing units in a fox clearing.
Yeah. So it forces you to do suboptimal moves sometimes, because if you cannot do every action in the decree, you collapse and everything in the decree gets discarded. You lose a bunch of points and you start over with just two cards in the decree.
Yeah, it's really nicely done. The cats are the most straightforward. There's nothing super special there. I like the way they have the cards do different things, but those individual elements are really cool. When looked at holistically and how they work together, I get less enthused. The barrier with any kind of direct interaction game is that you ultimately, those games can reduce to a simple political diplomacy game of kingmaking, effectively.
There's definitely potential for that in this game.
And the hurdle that a lot of these games have to overcome is hiding that. And Twilight Imperium does a good job of that. Dominant Species, I think, does a good job of that, although it's a little bit more in the forefront there. There's just so much you can do in Dominant Species to turn around. Like, there's so much mobility in terms of positioning and scoring that it makes that more interesting. Here, it seems a little too stripped down and bare of, like, okay, this person has a better position, we have to stop them. Okay, now this other person is in a better position, we have to stop them. And it's really easy to kind of view the game as this person can achieve X number of points this turn, and then that's kind of the whole way you view it. Like the Woodland Alliance, like we discovered last time that once
they have the best hidden abilities, yeah.
Once they build up, they can do some moves and get themselves into position and just score like 8 points in a turn. And the game goes to 30 points.
Or 13. I could have scored 13 that final round. I only needed 8 to win.
Yeah. When it becomes a game of just bash on the leader, it dramatically loses its excitement, and it kind of loses immediately, to me, at least in the games I've played, a lot of the narrative fun and the mechanical interest in kind of figuring out the puzzle of your race or of your faction, and it just becomes that political game that doesn't feel just that satisfying.
Kill the leader, and then it becomes this game of set yourself up in second place with enough points to score, but distract people with the leaders so that you can win.
Which is a criticism you can have of games that I love, like Dominant Species. That's my main criticism of Dominant Species, is it can do that, although I think most of the time it does a pretty good job of disguising that.
Which is interesting, because that exact strategy is one of the things I love about Twilight Imperium, and I haven't published this yet, but I've written most of a strategy article based around that exact idea.
Yeah, Twilight Imperium, I think, can get around it just by how big it is and how long it is. It has room to do a lot of the negotiation.
And it reduces to that a little bit, maybe on the last turn.
Yeah.
But there's so much game leading up to that that you don't run into that for hours and hours.
I mean, I think the closest parallel is Kemet. Kemet almost always falls into almost a pseudo king-making thing. But just because you're going to 7 points, like the points are so tight.
But with Kemet, you can't necessarily stop people from scoring, because all the scoring is done by attacking, or almost all the scoring is done by attacking. So you have to find a situation where, you know, player X, who is at 6 points, doesn't have a valid target to attack, but that almost precludes you from actively doing anything.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like I've been in that situation more. The comment I was going to make is that Kemet is engaging, and I think at least right now I would rate it as a better game than Root, because the progression of customizing your armies and that whole tech tree thing is so engaging. With Root, you're kind of just handed your strategy at the start, and it's just up to you to
execute it better.
Execute it and to effectively smack the leader down.
Yeah.
Maybe the game will progress into a version of that that's really diplomatically interesting, but right now I just don't see that happening.
I think it will, at least so far, it seems like it will end up playing similarly game to game.
Yeah.
Or at least kind of a similar macro pattern of the cats expand, the birds do their initial push, and then they do their final push. The Woodland Alliance sets up their sympathy and eventually has eventually creates their bases and tries to score out.
Yeah, which is a situation where, you know, the worst case scenario is that it becomes a game where the beginning game and the end game are really boring, and the only interesting part is kind of stuff that happens right in the middle that's not railroaded in.
Mm-hmm.
That's the worst case. The best case, it becomes really diplomatically interesting, and you find more nuances as we play more, which I'm hoping will happen.
Yeah, and I think both the barrier and the prerequisite to that sort of ideal situation that you're talking about is that everyone playing has a roughly equal knowledge of all of the races.
Right.
Because you have to know the capabilities of the other race in this sort of asymmetrical competitive game. You have to know what they're capable of to create your own strategy to end up in a self-balancing situation. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, the person who knows the game the best will just win.
Yeah. And just comparing it to the coin games, I think the coin games avoid that problem better because it creates much more interesting relationships between the different factions.
Yeah.
And it makes the journey more interesting just because it's more involved, it's more in depth.
And there's the historical element.
And the historical element.
Which, at least for us, is another plus.
Yeah. And I'm not even a history nerd, but just I think that adds something. We have to highlight how great the production is of Root. The art for is sure. So nice.
The minis are lovely.
The little animal meeples are great. I just adore the art. And I really like that they're kind of putting this cutesy, almost like Disney theme on a war game. But again, I think if you're comparing it to the coin games, it loses a bit because it doesn't have any historical background. It's harder to create the narrative in your mind when you don't have a lot of good parallels to how this is playing out.
Right. A historical conflict that you already know something about has at least some name recognition and some, if tenuous, emotional pulls of...
Yeah.
We know something about Julius Caesar, or we know something about the Viet Cong, even if it was before our time and we've never really studied it.
Yeah, it's got this kind of shared reference baggage in a good way that you can you can all use.
Societal baggage or something.
Yeah, yeah. Or
shared history.
So, yeah, something like that. That, which just aids it, I think, inherently. Although, you know, again, the art direction, everything in Root is really compelling. It just doesn't create a narrative experience for me. Mm-hmm. Again, I guess my ultimate criticism, other than the kind of railroaded aspect that I think it could fall into, is, well, I guess part of that too, is that it seems like a game that is very easy to view reductionistically. It's very easy to view it in such a way that takes away in your mind all of the theme and the narrative and the interesting interplay between people, and it's easier to just view it as numbers, which some games can do well, but this one seems a bit too simplistic on that front to work. But yeah, I guess that's the first impression of Root.
Yeah.
I don't think it's a bad game. I think right now I currently on BoardGameGeek have it rated as a 6 out of 10.
Okay.
But I could certainly see that swinging pretty wildly in either direction as I keep playing.
Yeah. I think it's definitely interesting. I am not sure what sort of staying power it will have. I think that would require... It might require like the same group of people to play to kind of develop a meta and then find a way to subvert that meta that we found in some of these other political games that really gives them legs.
Or it might just be the matter of adding the fourth player.
That is also something I want to try.
Right. Like, it could be one of those games that was really made for four players and any other player account's going to be suboptimal. Although I think I saw on BGG they recommend, like the hive mind of BGG has recommended it both 3 and 4.
Okay.
Not at 2, though.
It's a decent game at 3 for sure. It's definitely interesting. There's stuff going on.
Yeah, we'll see.
One kind of weird thing about the alliances, you almost can't stop them from scoring points. You can just kind of shape their strategy.
Yeah, I forgot. Yeah, specifically on that faction, when I played it the one time, I commented at the end of the game that I just felt like I was playing the clock, mm-hmm. playing as the clock, because...
Maybe they're the evolution of the cave from Vast.
I mean, kinda. a little bit. Although in Vast, everyone's a clock. Like,
yeah.
And I and the same for Root, but it felt like I was pretty much bounded into, until you get to the very end stage of development for them, they're going to score between like 2 and 4 points every turn.
Yeah. I think I had a more variable play. In the game you played as the Alliance, Matt fought you a lot. He was playing as the Cats, killed a lot of your sympathy, mm-hmm. which gave you cards and let you replace it from 1 point a card.
Which I think is what you have to do, because if they can get to the point where they have units out and can do that move and move then sympathy move thing. Sympathy thing, and they're scoring 3 to 4 points per sympathy dropped, like game over by that point. I think you have to stamp them down the whole game. And the game there in that three-player game might be infighting between the Cats and the Birds of who's going to do that stamping down.
Yeah.
I think that might be how the three-player game ultimately plays out.
Mm-hmm.
Which could be interesting. Yeah.
In my game, you kind of mostly left me alone, and I just did my thing. And so I kind of hit a wall of card economy because I wasn't getting the constant cards income from people attacking me. So I kind of had to slowly build up. But then I was able to score a ton at the end.
Mark is commenting, and he's played this game more than we have, that the Alliance really needs people... Or rather, the Alliance doesn't need it. The other players need to kill their bases.
Yeah.
Once the bases come out, which is something I missed.
And again, that's something you only know by understanding all the factions.
Right.
But that is fair. I don't think we've destroyed a base in either game that we've played correctly. So.
Right. Yeah. So we're still novices at the game for sure.
Yeah. My first game, though, I have to put this out there. I was playing as the Birds, and I played what I expect will be kind of the standard strategy of going recruit first to get a lot of troops out, and then your second choice is a little more open, but I went for the combat bonus because I was really fighting Matt a lot as the Cats. And we had this stalemate up in the corner of fighting back and forth of I could do more damage, but he had more troops for a while. Eventually, I overwhelmed and took it with probably some favorable dice rolls. But then on what... It came around to be what I'm pretty sure was the last turn, because I think if I did nothing, you would have won as the Alliance.
I think so.
And I don't think Matt could have won. Maybe he could have. I forget. I don't know what crafting he had.
Anyways, if you did nothing.
If I did nothing.
Yeah.
Maybe he could have attacked me and built something. But anyways, you were both at like 27-ish,
mm-hmm.
real close, and I was at about 20 points as the Birds. And I found a play where I could... And I had a huge built-up decree, so I had this really interesting problem of I had to go fight his home region because I forget if I had to build. I think I had to build on a mouse, and that was the only mouse region left that I hadn't built on. So I had to go for his home region, and then I had to also go for something else. So once I worked through it, there was a play that got me to 30 points. And we went through it, and I had the +1 damage from the leader, +1 damage for only fighting buildings. And so I had to roll not a 00 on the combat in his home region, because he had 2 buildings there and the keep.
And you can't build anything unless the keep is completely wiped out.
Yes, exactly. So I had to roll 2d4s and not get a 00. And I, you know, spoiler alert, I rolled the 00. And because of that... I wiped out 2 of the buildings,
mm-hmm.
and then he was able to move troops back in, reestablish control or rule, because he had the majority, and build there for like 7 points to win the game, which he couldn't have done if I hadn't gone for that play.
Right. So you aided him by killing his buildings.
Exactly.
Which is weird.
But I also gave myself a, whatever, 93% chance to win the game.
Yeah.
You know, 15 out of 16, which is hilarious and... I don't know. It was just a really interesting end to the game because I didn't think I could win. But once I worked through kind of the direction that the decree forced me into, I found a way that I could accumulate 10 points. And then it came down to the dice at the end.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, you had 15 out of 16.
Such is life. I can live with those odds. Yeah. Even if I'll gripe about it a little bit, but I would take those
you
odds.
You know
every time.
You had those odds.
I will make that play every time that I'm in that situation.
Oh, sure.
And be happy with the outcome, even if I lose more than, you know, 1 in 16 times.
Yeah. But I'm looking forward to playing it, and I hope we can get a four-player game in maybe this weekend.
Yeah.
Which would be nice. I want to play the Vagabond, because they're, the I think, the real oddball out of the four base game
factions. Yeah, they, like, jump between the forests, between the clearings.
They don't go into the clearings at all.
And they trade cards for the items that you craft, and then they do things with those items, and I think they, like, raid or something. And then they have to, sometimes they have to, like, sit back and repair their items, maybe. I don't actually know.
I haven't even read the rulebook portion, like, for it yet.
I've read half of the summary card for the Vagabond, and that's everything that I'm basing this off of. So yeah, there you go. That's kind of root first impressions. Not the best game we've ever played. Not terrible. Interesting with some potential. Some concern for it maybe becoming stale. But interesting. And yeah.
Although we should say there's already two expansion factions, and I know they've got like two or three more on the way.
Really? Okay.
They're really cool. Looking to expand this. So
nice.
Maybe that'll. I mean, that will keep it going.
Keep it fresh.
But it's certainly at this point not my game of the year. Like many, many, many people have said, it is.
You sticking
already with, their game of the year.
You sticking with Suburbia? Or sorry, not Suburbia.
Sprawlopolis.
Sprawlopolis. Yes, thank you.
I think last time I checked, that was my highest rated game of 2018.
Okay.
We'll see.
There's a couple months to go.
There's a couple months to go. Essen to go.
Yeah.
Which is big. And I've got a couple exciting review copies that should be coming in soon that I'm very excited about. So
nice.
2018, like the board game season is, it's shifted like a fiscal year because you get
Essen?
So many games coming out of Essen, which is right at the end of the year.
Yeah.
And then you often don't see best of until like the halfway point of the following year because people are still playing the games from the previous year.
So you're going to shift your calendar to start in like March?
I haven't even done my best of 2017. There's still one more game I want to play before I do that. The Expanse, remember? We haven't played it yet.
Oh, yeah. Maybe do you have all the pieces yet?
I did finally get from WizKids. Okay. Yeah, that was a pain. But maybe we'll play that this weekend also. That's supposed to be not too long.
Sure.
Yeah. And then I can finally do my best of 2017 list. Although I should probably play Azul. Maybe I'll see if I can figure out how to play Azul. I think that's all we've got for today. Thanks for listening, everybody. Thanks to our Patreon live stream viewers who gave us lively conversation throughout the podcast. I love it. If you want to get in on that, go to patreon.com/thethoughtfulgamer. And just a couple dollars a month will help us out, help us get better equipment. I already got some new audio equipment that we're using for the first time. I haven't listened to it in the editing room yet. I'm hoping it sounds really nice because thanks to the support of our patrons, I was able to purchase that. Don't forget to check out the website at thethoughtfulgamer.com. Hit me up on Twitter, on Facebook, and don't forget to rate and review this podcast on iTunes or wherever you get podcasts. Thanks for listening, everybody. Goodbye.
Peace out.